million residents of the Hamas-controlled Gaza Strip have been displaced, and almost half of all homes in Gaza have been damaged and destroyed. One outcome of a war is when both sides gain something of a value to them. The Israel-Hamas war is likely to end in that kind of scenario. Israel will win in the military terms, no doubt about that, but Hamas is likely to win in terms of a greatly increased following among Arab population everywhere, including especially in the occupied West Bank. The Palestinian Authority, which has been ruling there for the past 30 years, has become vastly unpopular, and corrupt Palestinian Authority President Mahmoud Abbas, the most moderate Palestinian leader Israel could have ever hoped for, has failed singularly in making any progress towards the objective of establishing a Palestinian state in the West Bank. He is perceived as collaborating with Israel in its hunt for terrorists, for the peace process has long been dead. Right of self-defense and the reality. A United Nations Secretary General Antonio Guterres has reminded the international community the Hamas attack on Israel on October 7, 2023, condemnable and despicable as it was, did not happen in a vacuum. Under Article 51 of the Charter of the United Nations, Israel has the inherent right of self-defense. The same article lays down that after acting in self-defense, the state concerned must report the action taken by it to the United Nations Security Council, UNSC. This does not seem to have been done. In any case, self-defense does not authorize the disproportionate or indiscriminate use of force against civilians. It has been reported that the Gaza's rate of death during Israel's assault has few precedents in this century. Almost 15,000, a majority of them women and children. This goes well beyond the prevailing customary law of self-defense. The most important and troubling issue is what happens when Hamas has been subdued. What takes its place? Some, including the US President Joe Biden, have suggested that the Ramallah-based Palestinian Authority should take over administering the Gaza Strip once the situation becomes ready for that. The rich Arab states, a phrase widely cited in the media, would be asked to finance the rebuilding of Gaza. The only problem is that the Palestinians in the Gaza as well as the in West Bank do not want the Palestinian Authority led by Mr. Abbas to rule anywhere, let alone Gaza. The only available option is to hold fresh election in Gaza as well as in the West Bank under international supervision as and when the situation allows. The United Nations should be asked to deploy a peacekeeping contingent on the border between Gaza and Israel to ensure security for both. The suffocating blockade of Gaza would be lifted. Israel does not like the United Nations and likes the United Nations Secretary General even less. It should be remembered that it was the United Nations that gave birth and legitimacy to the incipient state of Israel. The US will need to take the lead on this in the UNSC. Feasibility of two-state solution. Meanwhile, the proposal for two-state solution long pushed aside has come alive. Everyone seems to be repeating the two-state mantra, but how feasible is the two-state concept today? Then next jo hai, changing the tide. There seemed to be a rejuvenation in the hopes for a return to democracy in Myanmar if recent events in the civil war are anything to go by. The Tatmadaw, the junta, has never had a bigger challenge until now, since its February 2021 COP that ousted the National Language for Democracy-led government. The violence now and a reverse suffered by the ruling junta point to a new phase in war. Ever since the launch of coordinated attacks by the three Brotherhood Alliance (BBA) in late October, the junta has lost scores of bases and is being stretched thin as its forces have to battle opposition militia, especially in rural areas of the country. The junta sought to overcome the protest following the COP with crackdown, besides detailing NLD leaders in its attempt to reverse the changes in Myanmar's politics since its control democratization in 2010. But this has only led to the NLD and its allies, which formed a National Unity Government (NUG) in exile, creating rebel militia called the People's Defense Force, who, along with Karen Kachin Chin and Karenin ethnic forces, took on the junta even as their political representatives engaged in a dialogue platform for Myanmar's federal and democratic charter. The groups within the BBA, the Myanmar National Democratic Alliance Army, Tang National Liberation Army, and the Arakan Army, besides others, had initially retained their ceasefire status with the junta, but have now joined the civil war, weakening the junta's hold in the North San state and engaging in hostilities in Rakhine state. This, combined with the renewed attack by other NUG allied ethnic armed forces such as in Chin state neighboring India, has put the junta in a bind. Most international actors have condemned the COP but have stopped short of outrightly supporting the NUG, except for the European Parliament, which has recognized it as the legitimate government of Myanmar, while India has supported democratic reforms. It has cautiously cultivated ties with the junta as it seeks to counter China's influence in Myanmar. These ties seem to have played a role in New Delhi's allowing the junta's soldiers fleeing the violence in Chin's state into Mizoram and facilitating their return through the Morehe border. But with the junta reverting to its tyrannical ways of bombing civilian targets in its efforts to negate the growing resistance, even though as the NUG has gained greater legitimacy and heralding better prospects for a truly federal democratic Myanmar, it is in time New Delhi reviewed its ties to the junta. Then next one is Broadcast Regulation 3.0 Commission and Omissions. The Broadcasting Services Regulation Bill, released in November by the Ministry of Information and Broadcasting, is part of an arc of endeavors to regulate broadcasting in an integrated manner. The last initiative to take on this ambitious task was back in 2007 in the form of Broadcasting Services Regulation Bill, 10 years before that, when cable and satellite broadcasting was in its infancy. The Broadcasting Bill of 1997 scripted the first efforts to visualize an integrated regulatory framework for this sector. The recent third rendition of a broadcasting bill comes on the heels of a pre-consultation paper on national broadcasting policy by the Telecom Regulatory Authority of India, TRAI, a document initiated following a reference from the MIB. What it seeks to do and concerns. There appear to be three positive propositions in the current bill, albeit is requiring crucial refinements. First, it obliges broadcasting network operator and broadcasters to maintain record of subscriber data and subject this to periodic external audit, as is the international norms. Second, the bill seeks to stipulate a methodology for audience measurement and the sale of rating data. Both mechanisms will bring the much needed transparency in the opaque value chain of the cable and satellite television business in our country. That said, the bill completely lacks any guardrails to shield the privacy to subscriber and audiences in such practices of data collections. Third, the provision to permit private actors in territorial broadcasting will encourage competitions to Doordarshan, the state broadcaster, as in many G20 countries. Back in 2016, Dry had initiated consultation on this. At the time, there was an opinion about terrestrial broadcasting providing viable only for large players, including those already in cable and satellite broadcasting. Consequently, such a move, it could be argued, is likely to diminish the diversity of supplies in broadcasting as a whole. This anxiety can be pacified if the bill allows terrestrial broadcasting to those not involved in other forms of broadcasting. Apart from these potentially positive provisions, there are numerous apprehensions that arise from the broadcasting bill's manifest scopes as well as its noteworthy silences. A major concern is the bill including over-the-top content suppliers in the definition of broadcasting services, as also proposed in TRAI's national broadcasting policy. Intriguingly, both moves come amidst intense discussion catalyzed by the Ministry of Electronic and Information Technology hitherto mandated to deal with the online media on licensing OTT players. Now the MIB appears to poach on Mathis jurisdiction, a territorial slugfest typical in countries with a fragmented regulatory architecture for the news media and their audiences. There is a different concern. The bill's expanded definition of broadcasting constricts the condition in which journalists and news outlets that are not a part of the large multilingual television network can continue their professional pursuit. While it is fruitful for a news outlet to have an oversight body warranting a content evaluation committee takes the bill in a questionable direction, mandating an integral internal body to certify news programming. The issue is not only feasibility and cost but also desirability, since the role of an internal oversight mechanism is to maintain the accuracy of news and quality of journalism. Its design is best left to individual news outlets. They could decide whether to design this along the lines of an ombudsperson, as some newspapers attempted in the past, or akin to a reader's editors as practiced by few online news outlets. On ownership and regulators. Now, the two crucial silences in the bills, like the TRAI paper, the bill is mum on issues of ownership, while the bill is keen to stipulate a methodology for audience measurement. There is no desire to measure the extent of cross media and vertical ownership. Both these forms of media power hurt the diversity of suppliers and perhaps consequently that of viewpoint in the marketplace of news. In fact, just last year, TRAI itself had drawn attention to extensive cross-media ownership between newspapers and news broadcasters through indirectly owned affiliates and the need to evolve a system to capture this. Amusingly, one such news outlet with cross-media interest was apprehensive about inroad by telecom companies into broadcasting. They rightly feel such inroad add another dimension to vertical integrations, since some cable and DTH distributor also own in a round about manner news broadcaster. Both renditions of vertical integration risk the ability of the audience to access, avail and or afford news from a diverse range of suppliers. The bill is equally silent on creating an independent broadcast regulator, as hinted in TRAI's paper. This was first mooted in Airwaves judgment in of 1995. Subsequently, in the 1997 broadcasting bills, the reiterated in the 2007 iteration of the bill. Instead, the bill plans a broadcast advisory council to examine viewers' grievances and violation of program codes and advertisement code. This raises two concerns. First, the capacity of such a council to track and address grievances genuine or motivated raised by over 800 million TV viewers, and second, the lack of autonomy accorded to this body, since the bill empowers the central government to ultimately decide on the council's advice. Leave way to the government. In addition, the bill empowers the government to inspect broadcasters without intimating them in advance and to impound their equipment, presumably including those issued to their employees. Furthermore, violation of a program's code and advertisement code attract deleting or modifying content in addition to exiting measures such as seizing transmissions for particular durations. Finally, the bill grants a tremendous leeway to government to curtail broadcasting and its distribution in public interest, a term that is distressingly left undefined. All these intrusive mechanisms augment the vulnerabilities of a professional news supplier to external pressure groups. This should worry those who will deliberate over legislating the bill, irrespective of which benches they occupy in parliament. As the latest extension of the arc of India wants to devise an integrated regulatory framework for broadcasting, this bill must not lose the opportunity to protect press freedom and diversity. To do so, it has to will its way to incorporate some starting omissions, review its intrusive commissions, and fine-tune potentially positive provisions. The next one is understanding simultaneous elections. In September, the Union government notified the formation of a 6-member panel to examine and make recommendations for holding simultaneous elections in the Lok Sabha, state assemblies, and local bodies. For this purpose, the panel has been entrusted with the task of proposing specific amendments to the constitutions and any other legal changes necessary to enable simultaneous elections. The panel also has to give its opinion on whether the proposed amendments shall require the assent of half of the state assemblies as stipulated in Article 368. On October 25, the panel had an interaction with the Law Commission to discuss the roadmap to synchronize parliamentary and assembly election by 2029. Demand for simultaneous election. The first 4 general elections involved simultaneous election for Lok Sabha and state assemblies. It was possible then, as the Congress was in power both at the national and state level, the bifurcation of election has happened due to advancing of Lok Sabha election by the Congress, which after suffering a split in 1967 was looking to secure a majority of its own, riding on the populist appeal of former Prime Minister Indira Gandhi. As of now, the Lok Sabha election coincides with the assembly election in 4 states, namely Andhra Pradesh, Odisha, Arunachal Pradesh, and Sikkim. The proposal to hold simultaneous election has been pushed by the BJP since it came to power in 2014. After the Niti Aayog bagged the proposal in 2017, it was mentioned next year. In then President Ramnath Kovind's address to the joint session of parliament, he asked parties to have a sustained debate on the subject of holding simultaneous elections. The Law Commission also released a draft report on August 30, 2018, examining the legal constitutional aspect related to the proposal. Prime Minister Narendra Modi reiterated the need to hold simultaneous election in his Independence Day speech in 2019. Most recently, the proposal received support in the Law Commission report, which is reportedly exploring the feasibility of a common electoral roll. The case for common election. The following arguments are being pushed in favor of holding simultaneous election. First, holding separate election incurs massive recurring expenditure for the state and the central government. In case of simultaneous election, there would only be one electoral roll for all election, and the government would need the services of security forces and civilian officers only once. This would save public money and human resources that can be put to other public causes. Second, the dense electoral cycle involves prolonged deployment of security and police forces on election duty, thus posing a concern for national security and maintenance of law and order. The administration comes under strain due to the mass scale transfers of officials within the state, either by the government looking for High level officers in key position or by the order of ECI, once code of conduct comes into force. High ranking officers from the other states are also deputed or as observer in the poll bound state. There is a climate political uncertainty wherein officials remains perpetually in election mode. Third, holding separate elections comes in the way of development as the enforcement of the code of conduct for a longer period leads to the stoppage of ongoing development work. No new project can be started during this period, and even ongoing projects suffer from inertia. Looking to reap the electoral dividend, parties in power invariably indulge in populist scheme and do not commit to long-term investment in primary sector. This happens frequently, burdening the state exchequer. Fourth, simultaneous election would lessen the role of money in election, as campaign finance of parties would come down. The monitoring of election expenditure by the ECI will also become more effective due to a concerted effort at the national level. Fifth, given the increasing role of divisive politics for electoral gains, the One Nation, One Election plan would help in reducing the pernicious role of regular regionalism, casteism, and communalism in mobilizing electorates. It would help in bringing issues of national importance on electoral agenda. And finally, it is being argued that having too many elections creates a sense of fatigue among electorates. Voters' turnout at the national level has stagnated in the recent elections. Against simultaneous election, these are the arguments against the implementation of simultaneous election. First, the center's initiative is being viewed as being antithetical to the federal spirit, as there has not been wider consultation with constituent states, especially the one that are being ruled by the non-BJP parties. Second, holding simultaneous election would most likely push local and regional issues to the periphery. This would be a national constituency phenomenon favoring polity-wide parties due to their comparative advantage in terms of their claims to better serve national interest, national security, national unity, rather than regional parties who will be sidelined for focusing on narrow parochial issues. The simultaneous election in a federal polity would intensify regional discontent. Third, as far as cost saving is concerned, holding simultaneous election would require large scale purchase of electronic voting machines, EVM, and voter verifiable paper audit trails machine, VVPAT. Moreover, biennial election to legislative council, Rajya Sabha, and by election would still be held costing money and resources. For the frequent elections, rather than sagging the enthusiasm of voters, keep them enthused as evident in comparatively higher percentage of voting in state and local elections. Frequency of elections at different layers also help in increasing accountability as elected representatives and their parties remains on their toes. Legal and constitutional issues. Even if the proposal to hold simultaneous elections were to be adopted in the principle, it would require a complex and lengthy legal process to implement. First, at least 5 articles in the constitution shall need amendments. These articles are Article 83 Clause 2 and 85 Clause 2 that relate respectively to the duration and dissolution of the Lok Sabha. Also on the Legislative Assembly agenda would be Article 172 Clause 1 and 174 Clause 2, which provides for the duration and dissolution of the State Assemblies. Article 85 Clause 1 and Article 174 Clause 2 allow the President and Governor to dissolve the Lok Sabha and Vidhan Sabha before the completion of their tenure of the 5 years under the circumstances mentioned in the Constitution. Article 83 Clause 2 allows the tenure of Lok Sabha to be extended for 1 year at a time in case of an emergency being proclaimed under Article 352. Article 172 Clause 1 makes a similar provision for the State Assemblies. These provisions would need to repealed as of now. After the passage of the anti-defection law enshrined in the 10th Schedule, 52 Amendment 52 52nd Amendment Act 1985, the later Supreme Court judgment S.R. Mumbai case 1994, followed by the High Court judgment in Rameshwar Prasad 2006, the decision to dissolve the Vidhan Sabha and impose the President rule under Article 356 is subject to judicial review. The court can revive the assembly and restore the government if it does not find the grounds of the president rules to be constitutionally valid, as has happened in recent years in the case of Nagaland, Uttarakhand and Arunachal Pradesh. Moreover, such amendments need not only the two-third majority support both houses of parliament but also ratification by at least half of the state legislature under Article 368. Currently, no party has even simple majority in Rajya Sabha, while the state have different parties in power, many of which are not in favor of such amendments. It would also be much more complex and difficult to link general elections with local bodies election. This is because local government is a state subject. 7th schedule list 2 and all the state legislature have passed separate Panchayat Raj Acts and Municipal Acts fixing the tenure of these bodies 5 years as per Article 243E and 243U respectively. Since all 28 states have their own specific act, it would require changes in 56 sets of legal provisions. What next? Given the complexity of the issue, likely focus is going to be on how Lok Sabha and Assembly election can be held simultaneously. Even for that, multiple amendments would be required since the proposal involves center-state relations. Judicial review of the Amendments Act shall be major block. What seems doable is to make an attempt to club as many Assembly elections as possible to be held together or with the Lok Sabha election in one go and hope that the verdicts favor formation of a stable government. Even for realizing this, there is a need for wider consultation across the parties and constituent states. The next 2.23 lakh crore of crore to buy 97 Tejas jets and 156 Prachand helicopters. In a major move to enhance the combat capabilities of the armed forces significantly, the Union Government on Thursday accorded initial approval to defense acquisition project estimated at 2.23 lakh crore rupees that included procurement of 97 Tejas light combat aircraft and 156 Prachand combat helicopter. The Defense Acquisition Council DAC chaired by Defense Minister Rajnath Singh cleared the project at a time India is locked in a military standoff with China at a number of friction points in eastern Ladakh for over 3 years. The Defense Ministry said 98% of the total procurement will be sourced from the domestic industries and that the move will give a substantial boost to the Indian defense industry in achieving the goal of Atmanirbhar. The DAC also approved a proposal of the Indian Air Force to upgrade its Sukhoi 30 fighter fleet by state-run aerospace major Hindustan Aeronautics Limited. It further recorded acceptance of necessity or initial approval for procurement of two types of anti-tank monitors, namely area denial munitions type 2 and 3 for Navy. The top body on procurement of military hardware also cleared acquisition and integration for automatic target tracker ATT and digital ballistic computers DBC for the T-90 tanks, besides approving another proposal to buy medium-range anti-ship missiles MRASHM for the Navy. The MRASHM is a lightweight surface-to-surface missile which will be a primary offensive weapon aboard various Indian naval ships. The DAC accorded AONs for procurement of light combat helicopters for Indian Air Force and Indian Army and Light Combat Air Force aircraft LCA MK-1A for IAF from Hindustan Aeronautics Limited HAL under by Indian IDDM category, the ministry said. Though it did not mention the specific numbers, official sources said 97 Tejas light combat aircraft Mach 1A are being procured for the IAF and 156 light combat air helicopter LCHR being procured for army and IAF. In February 2021, the Defence Ministry sealed a 48,000 crore rupees deal with Bhopal for procurement of 83 Tejas Mk1 AJet for the IAF. With the additional fleet, the number of Tejas aircraft being procured by the IAF would go up to 180. Then next, a Navy gets ready for its biggest naval exercise amid ocean engagements. As the Indian Navy looks to mark Navy Day on December 4, it is also gearing up to host its largest multilateral exercise early next year, so the next edition of Exercise Milan in scheduled in for February 2024 and is expected to see the participation of over 50 countries, defense sources said, while noting that this reflects the significant expenses of the Navy's engagement as well as the capacity to assist countries in the Indian Ocean region. IOR as the first responder and preferred security partner, presence and operational reach by the Indian Navy through missions-based deployments and other operational engagements has steadily enhanced. There are 17 multilateral and 20 bilateral exercises that the Navy conducts annually, which exemplifies India's commitment to maintaining strong defense ties, a defense source said. These exercises are crucial for honing operational capabilities, sharing best practices, building mutual trust, fostering interoperability, strengthening diplomatic ties, and enhancing maritime security. They not only demonstrate India's naval powers but also contribute to the shared goals of ensuring a secure and stable maritime environment. Exercise Milan is a biennial multilateral naval exercise which began in 1995 and has since significantly expanded in scope and scale to become the largest exercise held by India. The mid-planning conference of Milan 24 was held in October. The last edition of Milan, which is held off Visakhapatnam, saw participation from over 40 countries. In addition, since July 2022, the Indian Navy has joined the Bahrain-based Combined Maritime Forces CMF, a US-led multinational naval partnership that aims to promote security, stability, and prosperity across international water. In IOR, Indian national ships and aircraft are being deployed for CMF-led operations on regular basis, sources noted. And earlier this month, India announced its decision to become a full member of the grouping. This year, the Navy Day will be held at the Sindh Hordurg port on western seaboard, built in 1660. By Chhatrapati Shivaji, the operational demonstration will witness participation of 20 warships along with 40 aircraft such as MiG-29K and LCA Navy, along with combat beach reconnaissance and assault demo by the Marine Commandos. This is the first time that Navy will be organizing a mega event which is not taking place at any major naval exercise, naval stations. December 4 is observed as Navy Day to commemorate the Navy's daring attack on the Karachi Harbor during the 1971 Indo-Pakistan War under Operation Trident. Maritime outreach. India has also significantly expanded assistance in capacity building to countries in the region. This includes giving platforms regular training as well as routinely deploying mobile training teams MTT overseas to facilitate capacity development. Recently, MTT from Indian Naval War Corps team undertook operational sea checks of ships of two friendly countries, Sri Lanka and South Africa, at Trincomalee and Cape Town respectively, where they worked alongside the ship's crew to achieve very high standards of operational readiness as well as safety compliance, as a defense source said. Similarly, INS Nirikshak conducted mixed gas diving training for Sri Lankan Navy personnel in Trincomalee, Sri Lanka, both in 2022 and 2023. To date, Navy has trained over 50,000 personnel from over 40 countries from the IOR, the first source stated. Then loss and damage fund cleared on day 1 of COP28. On the first day of the 28th conference of parties COP28, here on third day, member countries agreed to make operational loss and damage L&D fund meant to compensate countries already dealing with climate change to be based at the World Bank, but managed at an independent secretariat. The fund has received commitments worth nearly $250 million from countries. Through billion of dollars are still needed to meet its purposes. The fund was first announced at the conclusion of COP27 in Sharm el-Sheikh, Egypt last year, but it has taken 5 separate meetings since then through transitional committees to get a position where countries could unanimously agree on a text that was then passed by COP28 President Sultan Ahmed Al Jaber. The demand for such a fund is nearly 3 decades old. The UAE, the host country, and Germany made a financial commitment of $100 million each, the US $17 million, the UK approximately $50.6 million, and Japan $10 million for the fund. The European Union committed $145 million over and above the German contribution. Good momentum. Several delegates said that an agreement to kickstart the fund on the first day of the COP was a positive start and set a good momentum on tenor of discussion in the days ahead. Countries must build on this and generate enough momentum in the days ahead. We must keep our eyes on the prize of taking concrete steps to keep temperature below 1.5 degrees Celsius, said Simon Stelil, Executive Secretary, United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. Representatives, including heads of states from nearly 160 countries, have confirmed attendance at the World Climate Action Summit on Friday and will make statements. Prime Minister Narendra Modi arrived here on Thursday. The World Bank will be the interim host of the fund for a period of 4 years. All developing countries are eligible to apply for, and every country has been invited to contribute to the fund. Payments are voluntary, and a certain percentage has been set apart for a category of countries called the least developed countries and small island developing states. Loss and damage from climate change cost about $1.5 trillion, $1,500 billion in 2022, says a report published this week by the University of Delaware. Several developing countries and some of the poorest lost an average of about 8.3% of GDP due to climate change. The fund, as it stands now, does not specify how often it will be replenished. Harjit Singh of the Climate Action Network in International has been at the forefront of demanding the L&D fund for years. In a statement, he said, amid this historic decision to operationalize the loss and damage fund within a year of its establishment, addressing underlying concerns becomes critical. The absence of a defined replenishment cycle raises serious questions about the fund's long-term sustainability. Environment Minister Bhupendra Yadav thank the United Nations Presidency for facilitating the kickstarting of the fund. India has given it key inputs during the transitional committee meetings, and we thank the Presidency for facilitating this, he said. The next day, India set to launch X-ray polarimeter satellite, says ISRO. The Indian Space Research Organization has announced a plan to launch its first X-ray polarimeter satellite ExpoSat to investigate the polarization of intense X-ray sources. In a recent update on its website, the ISRO said that while space-based X-ray astronomy had been established in India, focusing on imaging, time domain studies, and spectroscopy, the ExpoSat mission marked a major value addition. This research supplements Supplementing traditional time and frequency domain studies introduced novel dimensions into X-ray astronomy, generating anticipation and excitement within the scientific community. The satellite will be launched by the Polar Satellite Launch Vehicle from the Satish Dhawan Space Center in Sriharikota. The date has not been revealed. The ExoSat is designed for observation from a low Earth orbit, non-sun synchronous orbit of 650 km altitude, low inclination of approximately 6 degrees, and will carry two scientific payloads. With these two payloads, the mission is capable of simultaneous studies of temporal, spectral and polarization features of the bright X-ray sources. The mission objectives include the measurement of X-ray polarizations in the energy band of 830 keV emanating from X-ray sources and long-term spectral and temporal studies of cosmic rays sources in the energy band of 0.8 to 15 keV. The mission life is expected to be approximately 5 years. The primary payload Pollux polarimeter instrument in X-rays is designed to measure polarimeter parameters, specifically the degree and angle of polarization in the medium X-ray energy range of 830 keV photons originating from the astronomical sources. The payload was developed by the Raman Research Institute Bangalore with support from ISRO centers. The secondary payload is the XSPECT, X-ray spectroscopy and timing payload, which will provide spectroscopy information within the energy range of 0.8 to 15 keV. The payload was developed by the UR Rao Satellite Center, ISRO. देन नेक्स्ट जो है कोर सेक्टर ग्रोथ स्पीड से 12.1%. इंडिया कोर सेक्टर ग्रोथ क्विकेंड टू 12.1% इन अक्टूबर फ्रॉम ए रिवाइज अपटेक ऑफ 9.2% इन सेप्टेम्बर विथ ऑल एट सेक्टर्स क्लॉकिंग पॉजिटिव ग्रोथ फॉर ओनली द थर्ड टाइम इन 18 मंथ्स एंड फाइव ऑफ देम लॉजिंग डबल डिजिट सर्जेस. बेस इफेक्ट फ्रॉम लास्ट अक्टूबर व्हेन द इंडेक्स कोर इंडस्ट्रीज हैज had grown a mere 0.7% and four sectors had recorded a contraction helped bolster the uptick this October. But output on average also saw a sequential rise of 2.84% from September 2023. The core sector constitutes little over 40% of the index of industrial productions IIP and their improved headlines growth augurs well for industrial output to grow at a higher pace than the 3-month low of 5.8% recorded in September. Electricity generation led October's performance with a 20.3% rise, followed by coal output that was up 18.4%, cement 17.1%, steel 11% and natural gas 9.9%. Fertilizers production grew at a 5-month high pace of 5.3%, while refinery production rose 4.2% compared to a 3.1% contraction last October. Fertilizer production has increased in preparation for Rabi crop sowing this month, and cement has benefited from a negative base effect as well as a pick up in housing sector, said Madan Sabnavis, Chief Economist at Bank of Baroda. ICRA Chief Economist Aditi Nair said base effect from last October, which had a higher number of holidays, distorted the picture. The shift in the festive calendar this year of obfuscated year-on-year comparisons in October and November, the rebate, thereby making it more meaningful to look at the average growth of performance for these months, she reckoned. Then, as the last two article, air pollution causes over 2 million deaths annually in India, according to study. Outdoor air pollution from all sources accounts for 2.18 million deaths per year in India, second only to China, according to a modeling study published in the BMJ The research found that air pollution from using fossil fuels in industry, power generation and transportation accounts for 5.1 million extra deaths a year worldwide. This equates to 61% of a total estimated 8.3 million deaths worldwide due to an ambient outdoor air pollution from all sources in 2019, which could be avoided by replacing fossil fuels with clean and renewable energy. These new estimates of fossil fuels related deaths are larger than most previously reported values, suggesting that the phasing out fossil fuels might have a greater impact on attributable mortality than previously thought. The team, including researchers from the Max Planck Institute for Chemistry, Germany, used a new model to estimate all cause and cause-specific deaths due to fossil fuel-related air pollution and to assess potential health benefits from policies that replace fossil fuels with clean sources. They assessed excess deaths, the number of deaths above that expected during a given time period, using data from the Global Burden of Disease 2019 study, NASA satellite-based fine particulate matter and population data, and atmospheric chemistry aerosol and relative risk modeling for 2019 in four scenarios. The first scenario assumes that all fossil fuel-related emission sources are phased out. The second and third scenarios assume that 25% and 50% of exposure reduction towards the fossil fuel phase out are released. The fourth scenario removes all human-induced anthropogenic sources for air pollution, leaving only natural sources such as desert dust and natural wildfires. The results show that in 2019, 8.3 million deaths worldwide were attributable to fine particulate matter 2.5 and ozone O3 in ambient air, of which 61%, 5.1 million, were linked to fossil fuel. That corresponds to 82% of the maximum number of air pollution deaths that could be averted by controlling all anthropogenic emissions. According to the researchers, attributable death to all sources of ambient air pollution were highest across South and East Asia, particularly in China with 2.44 million per year, followed by India with 2.18 million per year, they said. The researchers found that the most 52% of deaths were related to common conditions such as ischemic heart disease, 30% stroke, 16% chronic obstructive lung disease, 16% and diabetes, 6%. About 20% were undefined blood pressures and neurodegenerative disorders such as Alzheimer's and Parkinson's disease. They said phasing out fossil fuel and would result in the largest absolute reduction in attributable death in Southeast Asia and East Asia, amounting to about 3.85 million annually. The researchers said this is equivalent to 80 to 85% of potentially preventable death from all anthropogenic sources of ambient air pollution in this region, they said. So friends, this is all for today, and we will meet from tomorrow onwards with new news articles from the Hindu newspaper, which are relevant for UPSC perspective. So till then, thank you. Thanks a lot.